So now we get to hear someone who's beloved here at the University of Michigan. She did her master's and doctoral degrees here and worked with many children here as she developed piano performance and pedagogy on music of Black composers. And so she comes with her own fan club here already, and it gives me just great joy to introduce you to Dr. Leah Claiborne.
Thank you so much for being here with me today. I feel like I just want to come down and just hug everyone, but I know we're in COVID, and I'm just so grateful for this invitation to be at this incredible conference. I was talking to some friends earlier today, and I told everyone that every time I'm at a presentation or a performance, like what Connor just did, and Joel, I feel like I need a day just to fully sink into what I just heard, because it's just been so powerful and impactful. But today, right now, I would like to talk about diversity and belonging. More specifically, piano music by Black composers. And I have to tell you all that my journey with piano music by Black composers started here at University of Michigan, but not just started here, I have to emphasize that it was nurtured here, and that's a big difference, right? And it continues to be nurtured because of this fantastic institution, because of my mentors and my teachers. So I thank all of them because they invited me to speak today. When I was looking at the program, maybe you all have it, if you don't, please do check it out later. I loved this hashtag, and I don't know who I can give credit to, but I love this, which is look like a keyboardist. And that really, really, it struck a nerve within me because I thought about the many times that I have entered a space and, for instance, when I got accepted to college, I was so thrilled and I said, I have a scholarship. And the reaction to one person who didn't really know me that well said, what sport do you play? Or when I finally got to college, and I was, we call them orientation leaders, I said, I'm a pianist, can you help me to where the piano department meeting is? And they showed me where the jazz department was meeting. So these are biases, right? These are things that we don't often talk about, or at least we don't talk about enough within classical music. We know the right answer is anyone can be a keyboardist. Any person can look like a keyboardist. And although that's true, we also have to think about, okay, well, what music do we hear though on these concerts? Who do we usually see in the audience? I have to say this is a beautiful audience. I wish this was the case all the time. And also, who do we see in our schools of music, right? Who is taking up the space? Not taking it up, but I should say, who's not there? Who don't we see? What aren't we seeing to represent what does a keyboardist look like? And along with that, I have to say, what music are we also not hearing when we think about keyboard music, classical music? So today, what I want to do is share, I guess you could say like my top five or top seven or top 10 pieces that I absolutely love. These are pieces that I perform every year. These are pieces that I teach every year. And I want to approach this not because this is music by Black composers, which is wonderful, but this is music that speaks for itself. I was in a panel yesterday and that kept being this driving narrative, this theme. The music speaks for itself. If you just had the opportunity to hear Connor's music, the music speaks for itself. It's so powerful and impactful. So when we talk about the music in the forefront, I think that is a way to really start bringing people together, right? It's not about your political party. It's not about your class. It's about talking about universal feelings that everyone in this room has felt, expressed, and experienced. And these composers do such a phenomenal job of doing that. So one question I often get when I do lectures afterwards, they say, Leah, I want to do this. I want to perform a piece by a Black composer, but where do I start? And that question, honestly, it used to frustrate me. It frustrated me because I would say, just pick anything, pick somebody, just start there. But then I really started thinking about it and I thought about, okay, well, who was my first composer? What was my first experience? And for me, and probably many others, it was Nathaniel Dett. And I want to share that all of these composers that I'm sharing today, it's not just this piece, they have more than two, more than three, more than six pieces. So if for some reason you don't like what you hear, don't stop there. Go to this composer and look at all of these other ginormous amount of music that they have written specifically for piano. But there's something specific about Nathaniel Dett that I feel that the reason why he is such a great first, if you're dipping your toes, right, the first experience with performing a piece by a Black composer. And that is this understanding that these universal feelings that we all have, whether it's love or loss or grief or struggle or perseverance, it doesn't matter what your skin tone is because we all have experienced this. And I love this quote that this is he himself saying this, which is, we have this wonderful store of folk music, the melodies of an enslaved people, but the storehouse will not be of value unless we utilize it, unless we treat it in a manner that it can be presented in the choral form, in lyric and operatic works, and concertos and suites and salon music. And he goes on to say, unless our musical architects take the rough timbre of Negro themes and fashion from it music, which will prove that we too have national feelings and characteristics, as have the European peoples whose forms we have zealously followed for far too long. And I love this quote because Nathaniel Dett, it's almost like a plea. It's a plea for recognition in any ways possible. It's a plea for saying, yes, I am a Black man born in 1882. And yes, I am going through so many struggles that this country has put upon me. But I too have feelings. I too have a voice worth listening to. So the piece that I would like to share, by the way, this is a sample of some of his other suites. But the piece that I would like to talk about is In the Bottom Suite. And this suite has five movements, and I'll be playing two of them. And I have to tell you, these are two that I feel don't get performed enough. For those of you really into keyboard music, excuse me, the last one, Juba Dance, is probably the most popular. Very, very fun piece. It's often performed. And I just saw Dr. Patterson walk in, so I have to say his absolute favorite is his song. Every time I see him, he says, will you guess? Every time I see Dr. Patterson, he talks about his song when speaking about In the Bottom Suite. But today I want to play two different movements, which is Honey/Humoresque and Mourning/Barcarolle. And before I play these two, perhaps I've thought too much about this, but perhaps not. I really feel that there is a meaning, a reason why he chose two titles. You can see he has one classical title like Prelude, And then he has a more descriptive title, like Night, except for one, which is his song. And I don't want to get into that just yet. But I think perhaps, if we're going back to this theme of look like a keyboard is, perhaps there are times that Black people feel that they have to straddle two different worlds. A world where, for me, like, I have my family, and that's, you know, all Black people, and we cherish that, and we preserve memories and traditions. And then there's this other world, it feels like sometimes, which is when we step out of that, and that's society. That can be institutions. That can be all these different type of barriers. That can be classical music. And I feel that he's telling us or pleading with us that we too have feelings. We too long for love, for acceptance, for grief and loss. All of these things we too feel. So the first one I would like to perform is Honey. And I taught this to someone I think is in the audience. So I won't embarrass him. But I will tell you that when he finished it, when I was here, he told me that he thought at the end, he says, I think he got a kiss in the end. I said, I think you're right. I never thought of it that way. And then the second one is Morning/Barkerel. And you can really hear, or just imagine that you're in the South on a hot summer day in the morning, and you're in your boat, and you just have these oars going back and forth in the water, and you're just taking this journey on with the composer. Thank you.
Thank you.
so much. So if you are a pianist here, I definitely recommend Nathaniel Dett. There's so much character, so much to relate to with his music. And I also have to tell you, it just feels so good to play his music. If you're a keyboardist, you know what I mean by that. I want to move along to Betty Jackson King. When I left University of Michigan, I began working at University of District of Columbia, where I work now. And when I got there, I quickly realized how much accompanying I would be doing. And I have the pleasure, I will say it, I have the pleasure of accompanying so much music by Black composers, choral music, I should say. And I became very quickly to love Betty Jackson King through her choral music. And the reason why is because when you listen to Betty Jackson King's music, you listen to it, and for me, no matter what else was on that program, I still hum Betty Jackson King's melodies. And I noticed that too when I started looking at her works for piano. She has three works, The Aftermath. It's like a tone poem, if you will. It's a poem that starts off at the beginning of the page that expresses grief. The poem states that if something were just to be shattered, and then you just have to look at that, that's the aftermath. And she writes this incredible piece about that. The other piece, part of I'll play for you today is Four Seasonal Sketches. And then the other is Mother Goose Parade, which is a delightful, charming piece that has nursery rhymes embedded into it. So it's a little bit tricky for a student, but students like it, I can say that. For the seasonal sketches, yes, depicting the four seasons, and the two that I would like to share is spring intermezzo, I should say, and then also autumn dance. And I like to talk about these particular movements in two different ways. One being that for us as keyboardists, as performers, I have really, really enjoyed taking these four pieces and pairing them with Tchaikovsky's The Seasons. What I enjoy doing is taking perhaps a couple of the months of Tchaikovsky and then also pairing it with one of Betty Jackson King's pieces. And really just doing everything I can to what does winter feel like, or what does January feel like, what does autumn feel like, or what does September feel like, and look how the different composers have taken their stance on what these seasons represent to them. Pedagogically speaking, when I have taught these pieces, springtime, for instance, it's not springtime. Betty Jackson King, she has a piece called In the Springtime. That's why I keep saying that. Spring Intermezzo for piano. I had a student who was working on the Chopin Prelude in G major, which has really fast running passages in the left hand. And I thought my student could handle it. But I quickly realized, and you will quickly realize if a student cannot handle something just yet, I noticed they were struggling with it. So I thought to myself, is there another piece that I can think of off the top of my head that has similar passage work, but perhaps slowing it down a little bit so we can really kind of pinpoint the passing of the thumb? That's the technique that's needed for this. And I thought about this piece, the Spring Intermezzo, and I have to tell you, it has done wonders. After my student was really able to dive into the Spring Intermezzo, it really created this fantastic springboard for that vivace prelude that Chopin requires of us. And then the other movement that I wanted to share is Autumn Dance. And this one is also, it's not performed as much, but I wanted to talk about Autumn Dance because there's this fantastic ostinato or ground bass in the left hand. It goes D-E-D-A, D-E-D-A. And I know there are a lot of students in here. So when you hear the left hand, just keep, well, don't hum it, but in your mind, think about that D-E-D-A. you'll hear that go constantly. It never stops throughout the entire piece. So listen to those first four notes and you can keep hearing it. But then what's tricky about that is even though the left hand continues that, it's relentless, the right hand keeps being asked to do harder and harder and harder elements. But all the while, that left hand has to maintain untouched. So what we'll hear in the right hand, sometimes the right hand has to play underneath the left hand, which can be tricky. There is some voicing that's needed for that. The right hand has consecutive fourths that you'll hear. Then the right hand has triads. Then the right hand has octaves. And then it's octaves within the chords. So it just gets bigger and bigger and more wonderful. And then finally, with these sketches, the ending is so unique. And I always ask my audience at the end, what is the ending about? And I love hearing your thoughts. I have my own, but I'd love to hear yours afterwards as well. Sorry, I have to say this because it's so good. I had a student after I performed the prelude, spring intermezzo. She said, without me giving the titles yet, she said, I feel like the flowers have opened up in my heart. And I will always remember that.
Thank you.
piece that I'll be performing is the Samuel Coleridge Taylor's 24 Negro Melodies. I'm just gonna play one piece, but it's my most favorite piece. Not just by Samuel Coleridge Taylor, it's just generally one of my favorite pieces. And I believe Samuel Coleridge Taylor's 24 Negro Melodies, it really needs to become a staple in piano literature. We have these sets of 24 somethings, whether it's preludes or etudes by these great, great composers. And I really feel Samuel Coleridge Taylor was making his mark in piano literature with this grouping of pieces, the 24 Negro Melodies. And when I approach this piece for myself or for my students, I go back to Bach, because Bach told us in The Inventions that keyboardists need to learn how to sing, right? And I think it's because the voice is our most intimate instrument. And whatever we can sing, we have to be able to internalize. And once we can internalize it, we as keyboardists can then attempt to do it at this instrument. And Samuel Coleridge Taylor gives us 24 incredible opportunities to try to achieve that. Just in the same way we might approach the Mendelssohn song without words, right? The way we would want to try to handle shaping melodies, giving life to these beautiful phrases. So Samuel Coleridge Taylor writes, these 24 Negro Melodies, and the one that I'll be performing today is I'm Troubled in Mind. And out of the collection, there are so many famous ones like Deep River, Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child, Wade in the Water. But I'm Troubled in Mind doesn't get performed or nearly talked about enough. And the words are so simple and powerful, which are, I'm troubled, I'm troubled, I'm troubled in mind. If Jesus don't help me, I surely will die. And it's this repetition and repetition, repetition of that melody. And Samuel Coleridge Taylor likes to, orchestrate that melody in so many different ways just to really, really drive it in, really drive it in. So Samuel Coleridge Taylor writes this at the bottom of this, of the score. We know that this is his favorite melody out of this collection. And I think that speaks volume. And let me just read it. It says, one of the most beautiful melodies, and it says, it is said that a certain slave used to sing this song with so much pathos that few could listen without weeping.
Thank you.
thank you so much. I want to end with two pieces by Margaret Bonds. This is called The Spiritual Suite for Piano. And we have Dr. Louise Toppin to thank for bringing these spirituals together. Oh goodness, I forget when you did it, Dr. Toppin. A couple years ago, maybe 2 years ago. This, no, okay, okay. Thank you, March of 2021. And the piano world, if you will, has so much to thank for you for doing that. This really, there's wonderful scholarship happening, and Dr. Toppin is really leading the way with that. The last one, Troubled Water, has been the most popular because we haven't had much access to the others. But the two I want to play for you to end is Valley of the Bones, and then finally Troubled Water. And part of this notion of, back to this theme, look like a keyboardist. When we enter into space, enter into these spaces, I should say, of classical music, sometimes there's this expectation of how do I know how to act, or how do I know when to clap, or I don't want to say the wrong thing, or I don't know how to dress. These are all things that have been said to me when I invite people to concerts or to lectures. And I think that perhaps when we look at music like Margaret Bonds, who really bridged jazz and black idioms with classical music, you know, if we talk about these two different worlds, bridging them together, so that we're specifically just looking at the piece for its music's sake, which is beautiful, right? That we're not looking so much that this is the jazz influence over here and then the classical influences over here, or that's a riff from Liszt over here, that it's music that's beautiful and needs to be appreciated. So I haven't tried this before, but I'm going to invite you all, if you feel led to express yourself however you want in this piece, then not to be afraid to clap, or to, you want to dance in the side of the aisle, whatever you want to do, or you can sit there and smile behind your masks and I'll feel it in my heart, I hope. but the first one is Valley of the Bones. If you are aware of this passage in the Bible, Ezekiel has a prophecy, he's prophesizing over this valley of dead bones. And God says to speak life into these bones. And the universal aspect of it, I think about there are areas in our lives that need to be dusted off and shaken up, and we have to speak life into ourselves. And then finally, Troubled Waters. It's just a favorite, and I hope you all enjoy it as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And I have to say thank you again to everyone who created this conference. It's been phenomenal. And also, I have to say just thank you to Dr. Patterson and to Don Ellis and Arthur Green and Kira Thurman and Mark Clegg. They specifically have been mentors when I was here, and I've definitely called them and emailed them and asked for advice ever since. And they continue to be that support and advocacy. So thank you all, and thank you all for coming. It's always good to see you. It's great to be making music in front of an audience. Thank you.